Well, hey everybody, thanks for stopping back in at the Red Barn. Today's episode, we're gonna try something different. We're actually gonna show you the plasma table being used to make a part. And then, with that done, and the engine cradle all finished, the drivetrain's mounted in the 914 Ferrari. It's gonna be pretty fun. Hope you stick around. Today, I thought instead of focusing so much on the pieces as they're going into the car, we'd focus a little bit on making some of those pieces that go into the car. So I want to talk a little bit today about the plasma table that we have here at the shop. And it is an ArcLight Dynamics 5x5 plasma table. And I am running a Hypertherm XP45 plasma cutter. Certainly you can get something much more heavy duty if needed, but because of the nature of the material that I tend to work with, which is anything from, you know, light gauge sheet metal to the most I ever tend to get into is like half inch plate, and that's even rare. This today is going to be 3/16, and what we're going to be doing is making a very simple component that we're going to use as a fixture to help position the top plates of the motor mount. The Ferrari mount, this piece, has a big chunk of rubber in the middle of it. And because of that, and because this is a used mount, we can't absolutely positively guarantee that the base of this mount, which we're going to be bolting our top plate to get it positioned as we weld things together here, we can't guarantee that that's actually dead parallel to the base of this aluminum casting. And that's what we want. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. 0.0. In this case, nothing's good. What am I doing here? So we're using the fixture table here and a couple of these big square blocks to check something. And the check something is that Ferrari engine mount. You heard me worrying about how things aren't parallel. Look at that. And what you couldn't necessarily tell from there is it also rocks. It's not completely flat. And occasionally it goes to zero, but occasionally it doesn't go to zero. It's 2 or 3 tenths of a degree out, depending upon how it's bolted. And then when you multiply that by, remember I mentioned how soft this rubber is? I'm just going to hold down one side of it. And even just with my finger, look at this. I can get it. If I really work, I can get it almost 2 degrees out. So, does that stuff matter? Does 2 tenths of a degree matter? Well, here at the Red Barn, when it's the Ferrari 914, it matters. So this plate is going to replace this lower section, if you will, and then we're going to take the whole mount out, obviously, and then that plate again will fit here, and then we're going to make a spacer to take up this distance after measuring carefully, etc., so that we know that when we fixture this all together and bolt this back in, the top plate for the motor mount will be dead parallel to the base of this, which is what we want. Now, we're not going to run it with that spacer in there. It's just a fixture to get this plate located correctly. I'm using a little 2D drawing program called QCAD, and again, very simple design. These are the 4 bolts for the motor mount, and this is going to be the bolt that you saw at the center of the Ferrari, that cast aluminum mount that bolts to the engine block. So a super simple design, great little product, and once you've got a design set up, I'm using a product called Sheet Cam, which you then use to generate a tool path to say what gets cut when, what order, and you know what thickness of the material is that you're using, and therefore how fast can the torch travel on the plasma table, and how high off, you know, what's the torch height need to be, and blah blah blah, all this fancy stuff, how you want particular lead ins and lead outs set. So there's a bit of, not programming, but there's a bit of setup that you use, and after a bit of practice and getting to know what works best for your particular cutter and your particular table, you end up being able to very quickly generate the information necessary. And then this system, let me just close this up, this system generates, and I've done all this in the background, obviously, this system generates the G code, which is what you're seeing here. This is the X and Y and travel directions that is going to be fed to the plasma table so it goes to the right place and cuts the right stuff. And speaking of right place, you may not notice this, but there's an X here indicating that that's where the table, or excuse me, that's where the torch is on the table. And if I zoom out, you can see on a 5x5 table, that's where we're going to cut our little piece. And that translates to where the torch is. And I've already taken care of X and Z setting of the torch, so it knows it's in the 0-0 position relative to this piece we're going to cut. So with that set up and ready to go, I'm going to go ahead and run the program, and we're going to cut this plate out. So I'm going to hit run, and the next step, and then we come over and watch it do its thing. As you can see, even though this is a plasma table, it's a water-cooled system, and you might notice a teeny bit of steam coming off the part, but really, I'm picking this up with my bare hands right off the table. That's the joy of water-cooled tables. The goal there is it just helps the material lose its heat as fast as possible and helps reduce distortion and things like that. Okay, back to the engine mounts. The first thing I did was trim the top plates so they both contacted the upper cradle bar and essentially centered the motor between those two bars, just where I wanted it. And then it was to make the spacer that's going to be our temporary fixture to hold the top motor plate in the exact same location as the Ferrari engine mount. This picture shows things upside down, but you can see that the height of the spacer setup is the exact same height as the Ferrari engine mount, which means when everything's put back in the car, the motor plate is located exactly where it needs to be. And with the spacer fixture in place, the engine is leveled to the chassis, you can see the level in there, and the motor mount top plates are tacked to the upper cradle bars. Next, the drivetrain was pulled out, the cradle removed, taken over to the fixture table, and here you can see, to keep things dead level across both motor mount top plates, we used a clamping system, very simple approach, but it ensures that everything's dead level between those two motor mount plates. Then everything is tacked in place, the drivetrain and cradle put back in the car for one final clearance check and position check, and then everything gets bench welded. And this shot shows the inboard gussets that were added to the side plates of the engine mounts just for some extra added strength. Then everything was clamped as needed for final welding. And here's the result of that final welding. This is a shot of the underside of the motor mount. And finally, after all this work, the engine cradle is all done. So it's stuffed back in the car with the drivetrain, and we finally get to sit back and see how we did. It turned out like this. It's epic. It's so cool. It looks the business. So you've seen that shot before. Pay no attention to these guys. They're just little handles that we got welded onto some washers to help shim this thing over. And interestingly, you can see it's still not centered. And the reason for that is the mount is actually, I don't know if it's worn that way or whatever, but the mount itself isn't centered inside the transmission housing. So when I replace this mount, It'll get all literally squared away, and so that'll be dead center mounted. But so that's, again, pay no attention to this. How does this work out? The hanger mounts are absolutely lovely and beautiful and so cool looking. And then obviously the trans mount, or trans mount, the firewall tabs with the fasteners in there. Those aren't the final fasteners, by the way. And in the earlier videos, it showed a stud with bolts on both sides. I'm gonna run around from the underneath and show you. That's clearly not gonna be how they're done. They're gonna be done, you know, like that. We got the flathead on the bottom to keep the ground clearance issues at a minimum. And then it's a regular old bolt going up through that outside one. But here's the underneath of it, and you can see there's the crossbar and the underside hanger. Again, not the official fasteners. This was done so that I didn't eat into the nylock of that nut on the top. So this was just to space the fastener down to make it easy to spin that on there by hand, just to get everything fit. But you get an idea too of, you know, the underside of the mount, again, not completely bolted in, but in position. And the clearance is available. And I can't tell if this is a dead level shot of the bar to bar, but the engine cradle bars are just a tick below the bottom of the sump, which is exactly what we wanted. And you can see the tab ramps that'll serve as the leading edge of the skid plate. So there'll be a skid plate that, you know, kind of starts, you know, maybe here and then extends down and back to protect everything. Because it, as I said, it does hang down, drivetrain does hang down under the chassis. But super cool. And then here's the, you know, rear plate and the way that all mounts up. But it just worked out great. And it looks so neat. Here, let me do a quick full dress review of this. Again, wild video ride. It's maybe my signature, huh? Get this out here. But this will just give you an idea of how everything's gonna fit and the different perspectives you'll get. You know, so from the side, you know, this is the shape of the factory grill, and then the trunk starts here. Now obviously we're gonna have to do something about canting those pickups for the throttle bodies down to get things under the hood, but it just looks so cool. And then one of my favorite shots is, you know, when you look through the windows, the plenums poke out, and it's just gonna be ridiculous. And then I think actually my favorite view is, I don't know if you can make it out, but the prancing horse and the Ferrari logo, it's almost like it was made that way. It just hangs out the bottom of the car, and I'll scuff off the paint here. I mean, this will all get redone, but this will be shiny, so you'll be able to read it, and same with the horse. And so the back view of the car is this. Now, interestingly, someone had observed on one of the pictures that the motor didn't seem centered in the car. And that was largely because of what I pointed out up here, causing the back of the motor to kick off, or the back of the drivetrain to kick off this way. But look at it from the top. Now this is the center line of the chassis, and you can see center line of the castings and all that. But look how asymmetric the rear of the trans is. And what really starts to show it is when you see it from the back. Look how far to the left that thing ends up, which I think is perfect, because when you see that from the back of the car, it's gonna look like something's really wrong, which I just love. It's gonna cause, it's just another one of those little Easter egg kinds of discoveries that when people notice it or find it, they're gonna go, what's going on there? But the coolest, I believe it's the world's only 360 in a 914 swap. And having gotten it only this far, I can tell you, I think I understand why. Anyway, hope you enjoy. Talk to you next time. Take care.